Ministry, and I have a pleasure to moderate today's e-seminar. I would like to introduce today's speaker, Dr. Michel Langlois, who is a professor of University of Ghent in Belgium, working at St. John's Hospital in Bruges, and chairing the Department of Laboratory Medicine. Professor Langlois is the current president of two recently merged scientific organizations, Belgian Atherosclerosis Society and Belgian Lipid Club, and the past president of Royal Belgian Society of Laboratory Medicine. I have to add that Professor Langlois is actually chairing an European Atherosclerosis Society and European Federation of Laboratory Medicine task and Finnish group on laboratory testing for this lipidemia, and I have a great pleasure to be included in this group. The title of the seminar is Comprehensive Dyslipidemia Testing Beyond the Good and Bad Cholesterol. After the lecture, hopefully, there will be some time for discussion or to ask a few questions, which will be recorded. Michel, please, now is your turn.
Okay. So, dear colleagues, in this presentation, the data will be based for the majority on the guidelines for the European Society of Cardiology and the European Atherosclerosis Society for the management of dyslipidemia. However, in this presentation, I will focus on the laboratory testing aspects and other aspects developed in the joint EAS-EFLM task and Finnish group on laboratory testing of dyslipidemia. The guidelines were developed and they give some recommendations with different classes. So class 1 should be performed, class 2 it may be considered to perform, for instance, a test. And they always give levels of recommendation. Level A is the highest level of recommendation based on multiple clinical trials or meta-analysis. So for the management of dyslipidemia, there is a stepwise risk assessment approach. And first, we just start with testing blood lipids. So the initial lipid profile is recommended. The standard lipid profile also includes glucose or hemoglobin A1c for rule out diabetes and creatinine for renal function. To minimize the effect of biological variation of lipids, it is recommended to take the average of at least 2, but preferably more, measurements within an interval of 1 or 2 weeks, and never to test lipids within 12 weeks after acute major disease or surgery or trauma. The indications for testing are patients with diabetes, established cardiovascular disease, hypertension, smoking, obesity, family history of premature cardiovascular disease or familial dyslipidemia, chronic inflammatory disease or chronic kidney disease. So a high level of recommendation, and may also be considered in healthy men above 40 and women above 50 years, according to the guidelines. Is fasting required for lipid testing? Well, in fact, most of us are in a non-fasting stage during the day. So in fact, non-fasting lipid profiles might be a better indicator of average lipid exposure in the blood rather than fasting concentrations. And in fact, triglyceride-rich remnant lipoproteins, so chylomicron or VLDL remnants, are a direct causal risk factor for developing atherosclerosis. And there is a very simple marker, conveniently can be calculated, which is called remnant cholesterol, can be calculated from a standard lipid profile without additional costs. So when we look at the spectrum of total cholesterol, we are used to look at the bad and the good cholesterol, so the good HDL, the bad LDL. However, we never look at the ugly, which are in fact the remnant particles. It can be easily calculated from total cholesterol minus HDL and minus LDL cholesterol. And this appears to be a very promising marker, but needs to be confirmed by further studies. So why are these remnant particles also atherogenic? Because like LDL, they are very small, and therefore they can also enter the vascular wall, and there, like LDL, develop atherosclerosis because they are taken up by macrophages and so on. While larger chylomicrons cannot enter the vascular wall. So this was initial testing. So now we come to the estimation of risk, the second step. And regarding hypercholesterolemia and cardiovascular risk, in fact, total cholesterol represents about 80% of cholesterol, which is in the bad LDL fraction. And in population studies, a 10% increase of total cholesterol is associated with a 20% increase in incidence of coronary heart disease. So this points toward a major public health impact of hyperlipidemia. And on the other hand, LDL lowering of 40 mg per deciliter or 1 mmol per liter results in a 20% decrease in cardiovascular disease, as demonstrated in many large-scale statin trials. So it is in fact showing the very linear correlation between the degree of LDL reduction and the reduction of cardiovascular events. So a very linear relationship based on a meta-analysis of the all major clinical trials with statins. So this was the population level, but what about the patient? In the patient, there is no such a strong relationship because total cholesterol risk is modulated by other risk factors, such as age, gender, hypertension, smoking, HDL, diabetes, and so on. That's why in the individual patient, you have to estimate risk based on this multiple risk factor. And in Europe, the SCORE model is recommended. I will show you this directly. On the other hand, in a patient with familial hypercholesterolemia, all these patients are at high risk, even without the presence of other risk factors. So this is an example of a score chart, which is used by the European guidelines. So based on total cholesterol, gender, age, blood pressure, and smoking status. And score is in fact an estimate of 10-year risk of cardiovascular mortality. And a high risk score are all the red boxes, and is a score above 5%. So when you have calculated score, then you categorize your patient in a score category. So patient that is at very high risk when he has established cardiovascular disease, diabetes, or chronic kidney disease, or a score above 10%. A patient at high risk is a patient with familial dyslipidemia or severe hypertension, or a score between 5 and 10%. A patient at moderate risk is one with a score between 1 and 5%, but this risk can be modified by HDL cholesterol. We will see this in a minute. And a score below 1% is a low risk score. So now we come to the third step. There may be some need for additional testing in certain conditions. But first of all, you have to rule out secondary causes of dyslipidemia, thyroid testing, diabetes, liver tests, and kidney tests to rule out these potential secondary causes. And in a number of cases with a strong family history of premature cardiovascular disease, there are a number of additional tests we have to be performed. For instance, Lp(a), which is a strong genetic risk factor. We will also see this later. ApoB is recommended in patients with high triglycerides and family history to rule out familial combined hyperlipidemia. But very important is to perform a family screening of familial hypercholesterolemia, which is in fact quite a frequent condition. In every case, a very high total cholesterol, above 310 and above 230 in children. And this diagnosis can be performed using a DLCM score. it's not the same as the European score system we just saw. So there are a number of components of this DLCM score, for instance, family history, clinical history of the patient, if he has premature cardiovascular disease, physical examinations, for instance, xanthomas, the level of LDL cholesterol, and then depending on the number of points for this DLCM score, you get a probability to have the diagnosis of FH. So a score above 5, FH is highly probable. So after these additional investigations, you might consider high risk in certain patients with, for instance, family history of premature cardiovascular disease. If it's a man, in fact, you have to double the score. If he has a score of 4%, then he will have a score of 8%. Patients with a sedentary lifestyle, obesity or metabolic syndrome, very important, also can have an underestimated score using the classical system. You might consider higher risk. Also low socioeconomic status, impaired renal function, preclinical atherosclerosis by ultrasound investigation, familial hypercholesterolemia, we just saw this, low HDL cholesterol, then you have to use score multipliers, we'll see this in a minute, and all patients with high triglycerides, ApoB or Lp(a), particularly with a high familial familial history. So metabolic syndrome is in fact the clustering of abdominal obesity together with the other risk factors, high triglycerides, low HDL, hypertension and impaired fasting glycemia. It's quite frequently, and then the frequency is increasing, 20 to 30% in Europe. And they are at very high risk for type 2 diabetes and cardiovascular disease. But they frequently have no elevated total cholesterol or LDL cholesterol, and therefore the score is frequently underestimated using the classical charts. So after these additional investigations, you also can adjust the risk according to the HDL concentration. This is new in the guidelines. So as you all know, HDL is an independent risk factor, and at all levels of LDL, HDL, low HDL, in fact, adds additional risk to the total risk profile. However, HDL is a strong risk factor, but when we look at genetic studies, HDL is much less convincing. So, for instance, in the first column, when we look at observational studies, both LDL and HDL confirm their status as a risk factor. But in the second column, looking at genetic scores, so looking at people with genetically low or high LDL and HDL levels, so therefore LDL, the genetically high LDL, confirms to be a strong risk factor, as we see in clinical practice in FH patients. However, for HDL cholesterol, there is no significant relation with increased cardiovascular risk, whether your HDL is genetically low or high. So this means that HDL cholesterol is not a direct risk factor, but just associated with other risk factors, and HDL may just be a risk marker, just a marker that something is going on, but not a direct causal risk factor. Nevertheless, HDL remains a strong predictor of risk, and therefore, in the latest guidelines, multipliers of score have been developed to be applied on the score chart. So depending on your LDL level, HDL level, so when you have a low HDL, so your score will be multiplied, and there are different factors depending on women or men. So then we come to the most important step. So depending on your score, you will choose a strategy for preventive intervention. So event intervention strategies are chosen as a function of score and LDL cholesterol. So here LDL cholesterol becomes at the first place. So depending on your score, or independent of score, at all levels of score, lifestyle interventions are recommended. So a healthy lifestyle. If your patient has a score above 5, so if he is at high risk, and your LDL is above 100, then immediate drug intervention is recommended. If your patient is at very high risk, or score above 10%, immediate drug intervention is recommended if your LDL is above 70 milligrams per deciliter. And what are the targets, what are the goals of your therapy? So it is mainly statins. So a patient at very high risk, your LDL should be below 70 milligrams per deciliter or a 50% reduction in LDL cholesterol. If your patient has a high risk, your LDL should be below 100 milligrams per deciliter. And in a moderate risk patient, you might consider to lower your LDL to below 115. However, treating LDL may not be sufficient. Looking at all major trials with statins, you can see there is a risk reduction between 20 or 30%, 40%. So this means in all these studies there is still a residual risk above 70 to 80% for developing cardiovascular events. So there is a need to treat beyond LDL cholesterol. And in fact, is the LDL cholesterol can be very misleading, both from analytical causes and also biological factors. Let us first look at the analytical aspects. So both the direct LDL measurement or the calculated LDL are very prone to errors in atypical samples, with dyslipidemic samples. There the assays are not accurate. So for instance, looking at the Friedewald formula for calculated LDL, there the VLDL cholesterol fraction is estimated as considering a triglyceride cholesterol ratio of 5, so dividing triglyceride by 5 if you report a milligram per deciliter. In fact, this triglyceride factor is becoming inaccurate when triglycerides are already above 200 milligrams per deciliter. But the formula is invalid when triglycerides are above 400 in the presence of chylomicrons, and also in type 3 dyslipidemia with a high presence of VLDL remnants. And of course, because HDL is a factor in the equation, errors in HDL also contribute to the error in calculating LDL. But in fact, also HDL can be misleading because HDL is not a single particle, but a collection of different particles that differ in shape, in protein composition, in size. So you have small and larger HDL particle. So depending on the measurement procedure, we are not sure which HDL fractions are measured or which are not measured. So there is a lot of variation depending on the method that is used. Precipitation method or direct methods, and even between the direct methods. So to illustrate this, this is a study in clinical chemistry showing at the error of HDL, so the bias compared to the reference measurement procedure, which is ultracentrifugation and precipitation, according to the increasing third house of triglycerides. You can see that in most manufacturers, so in the highest tertile of triglyceride, there is a very high deviation from the reference method. So the total error, also in the second figure, increases according to the tertile of triglyceride. So this means that in these dyslipidemic samples, these compositions of the HDL are difficult to measure accurately. Now, what is the clinical impact of these biases? So we estimated this in an external quality assessment based database, which we studied in the EAS-EFLM collaboration project. So it is based on an external quality assessment of about 200 laboratories in the Netherlands of a serum pool with high triglycerides, which were distributed to these laboratories. So here you see a graph of all data reported by the participating laboratories in the Netherlands. And the red dot is the reference measurement measured in the CDC reference laboratory in Rotterdam. So you can see there is a huge variation depending on the assay manufacturer and the laboratory reporting in met and reported ADL measure data. Now, what is the clinical impact? So as you have seen, ADL is used for modifying the score. So we simulated this biased ADL, HDL measurement on a patient, considering a male patient with an initial score of 4%. So we applied all these data to this fictitious patient. So normally, according to the reference measurement, his score multiplier should be 1, so his score should remain 4%, which means moderate risk. However, as you can see, depending on the manufacturer, there is huge variations in adjusted score. So above 40% of the reported values are giving a score above 5%. So if we measure, for instance, with Abbott and Beckman, almost a minority of patients will have a high risk score above 5%. But if we measure with Roche or Siemens, the majority of your values will give a score above 5%. This means that these patients will have are candidates for statin therapy, while if you have measure another method, they will not receive statin therapy. So a very important clinical impact. Also looking at direct LDL data measured in this survey, you also can see, depending on the manufacturer, a huge variation in reported values. So with some manufacturers, all your LDL values will be above the high risk target of 2.5 millimol per liter. So all these patients will receive statin therapy if they are at high risk. While for instance, with the Roche method, about half the patients will not receive statin therapy. So a very important clinical impact. So this, you must remember that in samples with high triglycerides, the methods for HDL as well LDL cholesterol can be quite inaccurate and might have an impact on the clinical decision. But there are also some biological factors. First factor we have to consider is the residual dyslipidemia on patients with statin treatment. So it is observed in most statin trials that persisting lipid abnormalities persist. So in only about 25% of the patients have a normal lipid status after statin therapy, but the majority of patients still have some dyslipidemia. This may be LDL not at goal, or high triglycerides, or low HDL cholesterol, or combination of all these dyslipidemias. For this reason, the ESC guidelines considered to look at another parameter, another marker, the fact to target this residual dyslipidemia. So they recommend two markers. First is non-HDL cholesterol, which is a simple calculation of total cholesterol minus HDL cholesterol, and in fact this covers the total cholesterol fraction of all atherogenic particles, so LDL, VLDL, VLDL remnants, Lp(a). So all these fractions are comprised in this non-HDL cholesterol fraction, which can be very easily calculated at no additional costs. Or an alternative marker, which is the measurement of apolipoprotein B, because all atherogenic particles carry the ApoB apolipoprotein. So now look again at the analytical performance. This is a study performed in clinical chemistry simulating the classification of cardiovascular risk, comparing direct LDL, calculated LDL, or calculated non-HDL cholesterol. So you can see here in cases with normal triglycerides or moderately elevated triglycerides, you can see there is quite some misclassification for direct LDL, calculated LDL, and also for non-HDL cholesterol. However, when we look at patients with high triglycerides, you can see already some quite misclassification for the calculated LDL and also for direct LDL. But here, non-HDL cholesterol in this population performs quite well. So in patient, again, in samples with high triglycerides, non-HDL cholesterol may be an appropriate marker. So what are the guidelines? What are the recommendations? So the ES guidelines recommended some primary and secondary targets. So the primary target is LDL cholesterol. So like less than 70 in very high risk, less than 100 in high risk patients. And then for non-HDL cholesterol and ApoB, they are given a secondary target. This means that if your LDL target has been achieved or your non-HDL is still high, then you have to treat further these patients, either by increasing statin therapy or adding a fibrate to reduce triglycerides. And this secondary target is particularly recommended in patients with combined dyslipidemia, such as patients with metabolic syndrome, type 2 diabetes, or chronic kidney disease. This is results from a meta-analysis of statin trials. So looking at different categories, whether your LDL or non-HDL target has been achieved or not. So when we look at the third category, so patients have reached their LDL target, but still have are above non-HDL target, then you have a higher risk comparing to patients which have received achieved all their targets. So a very additional risk estimation. Here again, for LDL cholesterol, there's a linear relationship shown from most trials with statins and also with fibrates, a quite linear relationship between the degree of non-HDL reduction and the reduction in coronary heart disease risk. So that dosis-response relationship. So this was a residual dyslipidemia on treatment. Another aspect to be considered where LDL can be misleading is a small dense LDL subclass phenotype. So like for HDL cholesterol, LDL cholesterol is not one single particle, but a collection of different particles that differ in size and composition. And particularly in conditions with high triglycerides, there are a high number of smaller LDL particles, LDL3 or LDL4, which are derived from VLDL remnants. So this, for example, an elective rhesus profile of an LDL subclasses. So this is a low-risk profile of LDL, so predominantly LDL 1 and 2 particles, so larger particles. But this is a profile of a patient with normal LDL and total cholesterol. You can see a large number of smaller particles, LDL 3, 4, and even 5, and 6, and 7, so very small particles. But apparently with a normal LDL cholesterol concentration. You can see this clearly considering two patients with a normal LDL cholesterol, 105, but the first patient has normal triglycerides, the other patient has high triglycerides. You can see in the patients with high triglycerides, there is a completely different distribution of LDL subclasses. So there is a majority of small, dense LDL particles, while in the first patient with exactly the same LDL cholesterol, there is a majority of large LDL particles. So there, if you just look at LDL cholesterol, your LDL profile can be very misleading. So why are these LDL particles so atherogenic, these small particles? Because they can more easily enter the vascular wall. And there within the vascular wall, they are oxidized and taken up by macrophages. And then, of course, the atherosclerosis lesion is developed. Of course, measuring these small LDL particles in a routine laboratory with low turnaround time requirements, it's not feasible to perform these complicated techniques. And there is a need for a convenient, fast method to estimate these small particle phenotypes. Is there such a method? Well, yes, there is. Very simple. Just measure ApoB. What is the principle of ApoB measurement? So in each atherogenic particle, whether it's VLDL or VLDL remnant or normal LDL or small LDL, each particle has only one ApoB molecule on his surface. And also ApoA1, as you can see, is a marker of number of HDL particles. So now coming back to two patients with exactly the same LDL cholesterol. So in the first patient, he has normal triglycerides. He has a low ApoB. The second patient with exactly the same LDL cholesterol has a high ApoB concentration. This means in the second patient, for the same cholesterol content, he has a higher number of LDL particles, which are indeed smaller. So ApoB is a marker of the number of atherogenic particles. So is there a place for intervention strategies as a function of ApoB? Because LDL is not sufficient, as we have seen, there is only a risk reduction of about 20 or 30%. So can you reduce more risk if you target your medication to ApoB or non-HDL cholesterol? While looking at a meta-analysis of observational studies, comparing the relative risk ratios of LDL cholesterol, non-HDL cholesterol, or ApoB, you can see that both non-HDL cholesterol and ApoB perform slightly better for predicting risk, so there is more additional risk comparing to LDL cholesterol. And looking at the differences between relative risk ratios, you can see that for the first column, non-HDL is quite comparable with ApoB, with slightly in favor of ApoB. Non-HDL has added value slightly above LDL, but ApoB has a much more added value above LDL for predicting risk. So there is an incremental risk for measuring ApoB above LDL cholesterol. Looking at one of these studies from this meta-analysis, the Women's Health study, this is recently published by Paul Ritker in The Lancet, clearly shows the incremental risk prediction value of non-HDL cholesterol or ApoB above LDL cholesterol. And looking at discrepant or concordant values of LDL and ApoB, you can see in the second figure, if both LDL and ApoB are concordantly elevated, there is much higher incidence of coronary heart disease in this Women's Health study if only LDL was elevated. And in the figure above, you can see that if LDL is normal and ApoB is elevated, and these are patients in fact this small dense LDL phenotype, because LDL is normal but ApoB is elevated, so a higher number of LDL small particles, there is a much higher incidence of coronary heart disease compared to normal ApoB values. So an important added value of ApoB above LDL cholesterol. In contrast, these were observational studies. When we're looking at statin trials, so interventional studies, so in this meta-analysis, you can see that the added value of non-HDL cholesterol or ApoB is much less convincing. However, it's not weaker than LDL cholesterol. But in a more recent meta-analysis published last year, you can see that third decrease in standard deviation of all these markers, you can see that for ApoB, there is a higher degree of risk reduction if you decrease your ApoB with one standard deviation compared to LDL or non-HDL cholesterol. So with LDL or non-HDL cholesterol, you have a risk reduction of about 20-25%. If you decrease ApoB with one standard deviation, you have a risk reduction almost 30%. So what are the advantages of measuring ApoB? Well, from an analytical point of view, I don't have to convince you that ApoB is a simple automated assay, immunoassay. It's also compared to this complicated lipoprotein particles, a single well-defined molecule, and there is no international standard available from IFCC. From a clinical point of view, we have seen from this meta-analysis that ApoB is superior, or at least comparable to LDL and non-HDL cholesterol to predict cardiovascular risk. And ApoB is able to identify persons with a small dense LDL phenotype, while HDL, this non-HDL cholesterol does not. However, there are some disadvantages. ApoB tests are not widely available in laboratories, so this is not convenient for the practitioners to follow your patients with ApoB. In most countries, there's no reimbursement for ApoB tests. ApoB, of course, is more expensive than the simple calculation of non-HDL cholesterol, which can be done at no additional cost. And it still has to be confirmed by more studies that therapeutic targeting ApoB beyond LDL cholesterol or non-HDL cholesterol can reduce more cardiovascular events or deaths or improve healthcare economics. This needs to be confirmed by further studies. And a last factor to be considered, a last biological factor, is the presence of Lp(a). So Lp(a) is a very special LDL particle to which is attached an apolipoprotein A molecule, which contains 10 different types of Kringle 4-like structure. We are very similar to plasminogen. And the Kringle 4 type 2 domain can be present in multiple repeated copies. There can be 2 copies, or there can be more than 40 copies. And so they are very difficult ApoA isoforms. So the length of this ApoA molecule can vary between individuals. In effect, the plasma Lp(a) concentration is genetically determined by this variation in ApoA size. So Lp(a) is an independent risk factor, independent of LDL cholesterol, non-HDL cholesterol, and other risk factors. And it is recommended that Lp(a) should be measured once using an assay that independent of ApoA isoform size. In which subject? Well, in all subjects, and it's in moderate or high risk with premature cardiovascular disease, familial hypercholesterolemia, a family history of premature cardiovascular disease or elevated Lp(a), and on treatment, recurrent cardiovascular disease despite statin treatment, despite achieving your LDL goals. So there you must think about the presence of Lp(a) when your LDL can be misleading. So in summary and in conclusion, I hope you have convinced you that high-risk patients can be missed and therefore undertreated if you just measure total and LDL cholesterol. Applying multipliers of score with HDL can help to identify more of these high-risk patients. HDL is not a causal risk factor, but is a strong risk marker associated with atherogenic dyslipidemias. So you can identify more of these patients, for instance, metabolic syndrome. Also, familial hypercholesterolemia, FH, and Lp(a) are underdiagnosed and therefore undertreated. So it is important in patients with a strong family history to look for FH and Lp(a). And for analytical reasons, but also biological reasons, classical standard lipid tests are not accurate, and therefore, in samples with high triglycerides and combined dyslipidemia, so in patients with residual dyslipidemia or presence of dyslipidemia associated with diabetes or chronic kidney disease, it is recommended to target your therapy on non-HDL cholesterol, which is a free calculation, or ApoB measurement in all these patients as a secondary treatment goal. So I thank you for your attention. I will be happy to answer your questions. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much, Michel. It was a great collection of very interesting data. I don't know if our participants, because I see that they have the microphone crossed, so I will take the occasion to ask you for some comments. First of all, I would like to hear your comments on triglycerides on the inaccurate calculated LDL cholesterol when triglycerides are over 200 milligrams per deciliter. I totally agree with that. I'm very much in favor, and I say this to my students. However, our clinicians, cardiologists say that there are no guidelines, there are no recommendations to use this cutoff value. I know that there were some papers published in Clinical Chemistry on that subject. However, could you comment on that cutoff value for triglycerides 200 or over 200 milligrams per deciliter?
Well, do you mean for treating high triglycerides or for?
No, just to use when you are in the laboratory and when you measure triglycerides and you have triglycerides over 200 milligrams per deciliter, then you decide to measure LDL cholesterol with the direct method, not to calculate. Or you can say to the clinician that the result for calculated LDL with such triglycerides is inaccurate. But they say that, of course, calculated LDL cholesterol is much cheaper than LDL direct measure. So, and they say that there is no guidelines and no recommendations right now. So what do you think on that?
So in our laboratory here, we choose a cutoff in between. If triglycerides are above 300, we simply do not calculate LDL. And but also for economic reasons, we do not measure directly LDL. But I systematically report non-HDL cholesterol on my lab reports. So I think as a kind of reflex testing in all samples with high triglycerides, you should automatically report non-HDL cholesterol.
Okay.
On your lab reports.
Yeah, so this is a very, very good solution, I think. And I think that many of us who are working in the lab and they have the decision should use this, what you suggest. What else? So non-HDL cholesterol is becoming a star right now, would say. I was very much impressed with the recent data by Ritker you showed, which on the predictors of first ever cardiovascular event in apparently healthy women. You didn't focus on that, but for sure you know what is at the bottom of the slide. At the bottom of the slide this is the slide 67. At the bottom of the slide, you have the old ratio of total cholesterol to HDL cholesterol, which gives the highest hazard ratio, which is comparable to ApoB, to ApoA1, and then triglycerides. So, and then non-HDL cholesterol, I think 2.5, 2.7 and 2.82, they are very similar values. So the old ratio of total cholesterol to HDL cholesterol seems to be the best.
Yes, I was also surprised by this, seeing this. This is in fact, in the old score charts, you can use total cholesterol divided by HDL cholesterol. But in the new guidelines, like I showed you, this ratio is not used anymore. And there you have to multiply your score according to HDL cholesterol. But I was also surprised to see this.
That was very impressive. My last question will be, I would like to have your comment on ApoB. ApoB is very attractive measurement. We have also done some projects with measuring ApoB. As you know, for sure, ApoB is available on some automatic analyzer. At least there are some applications for these analyzers. I know that this is more expensive, but it also has the advantage that you do not need to measure it in the fasting plasma or serum. This is very, very important, especially for general practitioners. Yeah. I think we should more emphasize to measure ApoB. However, as you said, there are more studies needed to have to define the target value for treatment for ApoB.
I totally agree from an analytical point of view, but it's very difficult to convince the clinicians. They are so
I know.
The general practitioners are so familiar with the good and bad cholesterol. So if we talk about ApoB, they it's very difficult to have this generalized. So
I know that. However, you know that this is what we should do. We should create the opinions, and we should try to persuade to our clinicians what is the best. But maybe this will be a question the near future.
If you measure only ApoB and don't measure, in fact, I calculated the costs for calculating LDL is in fact the same for ApoB, because for LDL you need a measurement of HDL, total cholesterol.
Of course.
If you use all these three measurements, you have the same costs for ApoB.
I did the same in the morning. So I think we should try to persuade to our clinicians. So I would like once again to thank you very, very much for a great presentation. And I think it's time to for our participants, maybe some of them. I don't know, Daniel, if it is possible that somebody can ask questions.
There are a lot of questions for Professor in the chat, so maybe I will read them.
Yeah.
So one from Elvar is, what is known about possible biases for ApoB methods in Europe?
Question for Michel.
Well, we did this. I did not show the slide, but we also looked at in this Dutch external quality assessment in our working group at EFLM. We also looked at the bias, and there was some bias and imprecision, but it was much better than for LDL or non-HDL cholesterol. I didn't show the slide, but I have here my publication with me, so that the for ApoB, the bias was minimal, so less than 1%. So it was very much better than for the classical lipids. So in this Dutch external quality assessment that we studied, of course there was some imprecision, but the bias was very much better than the traditional lipids. That's because there is an international standard.
Yeah, thank you very much, Michel, and thank you very much, Elvar, for this question. For sure, you were the only person who could ask for bias, because this is your favorite issue, and you had the e-seminar before our e-seminar on the bias. Maybe somebody else would like to ask a question, Daniel. Are there any questions?
Yes, there is a question from Francesca, and she asks, what's your opinion on using calcium as another parameter for the assessment of cardiovascular disease risk together with the parameters seen today?
Yes, calcium seems to be a very promising risk factor for atherosclerosis and also calcification of heart valves and so on. There are some promising studies, but they need to be confirmed by further studies. But I totally agree, this is a very promising marker. Yes. But there are further studies are needed. It cannot be recommended yet in the guidelines, because there has to be more evidence for this.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so now it's your turn, Daniel. Are there any more questions from our participants?
There is a question from Andreas, who asks, what about calculation for ApoB ApoA ratio? Any risk assessment for by this ratio? Any approved guidelines for these values?
Well, ApoB, as I have shown you, is a
ApoB to ApoA ratio.
Yeah. I will go to the slide.
Yeah.
ApoB.
Until Michelle will find the slide, there were some old data by Swedish authors, as far as I remember, values. It was in 2001. So now, please, Michelle.
Yeah, the Morris study. ApoB in the guidelines, ApoB A1 ratio is recommended in the guidelines for risk assessment, like the ratio of total ACL cholesterol, but it's not recommended as a therapeutic target. But it is recommended as a alternative for risk assessment. Because for ApoB, there is, for meta-analysis, some added value above LDL, but for ApoA1, there's no added value above HDL. So if you measure ACL or ApoA1 from population studies, there is no incremental value. But of course, the ApoB1 ratio is a very strong risk factor. Yeah.
Thank you very much for this question. It was a good question, but the answer was even better. Daniel, do we have any more questions?
Yes, we have. Asim asks, do you suggest any other calculations from a pre-developed formula when triglycerides are under 200 milligrams per deciliter for clinical use?
Yes, very interesting question. There are some recent papers in clinical chemistry. There are two and others in other journals, which I don't remember, but with adaptations of the Friedewald equation, depending on the level of triglycerides. So normally Friedewald, there is a standard cholesterol triglyceride ratio of 1:5. But it is in these recent papers, I didn't show the slides, but there are some adapted Friedewald equations according to the level of triglycerides. So this VDL cholesterol factor is modified according to the level of triglycerides, and these papers look very promising for having more accurate LDL calculation. Yes, that's true. Yeah.
Exactly. Very good answer. These papers, I think, have been published last year in clinical chemistry.
Yes, yeah.
However, the formulas for calculating, I think, are very complicated, and we need some computer scientists to help us to write a program we had the one for MDRD formula for EGFR. Daniel, do we have any more questions?
One question is, I have to ask you if the analysis of the LP small a level consider the oxidative status or not?
That's a very difficult question, because in fact it is known from studies that small LDL is indeed is more prone to oxidation because it can enter the vascular wall. But the oxidation of LDL occurs within the vascular wall and apparently not in the circulation, because in the circulation you have plenty of antioxidants like vitamin C and so on, and also vitamin E, which is present in the LDL particle, who can stop the oxidation process as an antioxidant. But in the microenvironment of the vascular wall, there these small particles are more prone to oxidative processes. And it appears that if you measure oxidized LDL in the plasma, this LDL originates from back diffusion from atherosclerotic plaques. So if you measure oxidized LDL fractions, for instance by an ELISA, the fact that it reflects the number of plaques in your body, atherosclerotic plaques in your body. So there is no direct relationship between small LDL and oxidized LDL, because in fact this oxLDL fraction that you measure originates from atherosclerotic plaques.
Mm-hmm.
Is this clear for your answer?
Yeah, I think so. It was a very difficult question, but the answer was great.
It's a difficult issue. There's not many evidence about this.
Exactly. So we have last 2 minutes, Daniel. Do we have any more questions?
Katarzyna asked, I lost this. Yes. In your opinion, which parameter would be the most appropriate for evaluation of cardiovascular disease risk in subjects with pre-diabetes or type 2 diabetes?
Well, there, of course, non-HDL cholesterol is the best marker, because diabetes, you might have normal LDL, but you have this atherogenic dyslipidemia. So I'll go to this following slide. So this one. So if you calculate non-HDL cholesterol, so in diabetes they also have a high number of VLDL remnants and so on. So and there in diabetics, non-HDL cholesterol is a better marker of risk. That's true. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Michel, and thank you very much, Katarzyna, for this question. Last chance, 1 minute left, Daniel.
So the last question is from Asim. What are you thinking about postprandial lipemia for risk assessment for cardiovascular disease?
Well, very important question. Yes, very important. So as I go to the
one of the first slide. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So it seems that so the postprandial state, of course, if you measure triglycerides, there is an enormous fluctuation according in the pre or postprandial state. So triglycerides are not very convenient, because there is a lot of variation. But if you calculate remnant cholesterol, there is almost very little variation. This can simply be calculated, because we'll go to the next slide. Your VLDL remnants, if your triglycerides are hydrolyzed by lipoprotein lipase, then your triglycerides are removed from these VLDL particles or chylomicrons. Then you have these remnant particles, which are in fact very rich in cholesterol, more than LDL. And like I demonstrated, they are very atherogenic. So in fact, most of us are in the postprandial state. So, and if you measure non-fasting lipids, this might more reflect the more realistic status of your lipid status on a daily basis. So in fact, if you measure fasting lipids, you may miss some risk profile.
Right.
So there are some data from the Copenhagen Heart Study from Borg and Ordeskaart, which are very promising, but this has to be confirmed by further studies. But it appears that, and even in Denmark, I believe that now non-fasting lipids recommended. They don't use fasting lipids anymore. So in fact, you might have a better risk estimate if you measure non-fasting lipids, but without measuring triglycerides, of course, but calculating this remnant cholesterol, which shows less variation according to the prandial status.
Yeah, great answer. Even triglycerides in a fasting, in a non-fasting state, are not so much higher than not so much higher than in a non-fasting. Thank you very much, Michelle, for a great presentation. For your great answer, and I would like to thank Daniel also, and I would like to thank everybody who was listening, and I wish you everybody a very nice evening. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bye.